Welcome to the Beginner's Big Book AA meeting. I'm Mike and I'm an alcoholic. Hi, everybody.
Hi, Mike.
I'll be your chairperson for the month of January. Can we now go around the room and introduce ourselves?
Lisa, alcoholic.
Hi, Lisa.
Harvey, alcoholic.
Hi, Harvey.
Carl, alcoholic.
Hi, Carl.
Steve, alcoholic.
Hi, Steve.
Jim, alcoholic.
Hi, Jim.
Casey, alcoholic.
Hi, Casey.
Nick, alcoholic.
Hi, Nick. Let's open up tonight's meeting with a moment of silence followed by the serenity prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen. Are there any new people here tonight? Are there any announcements for the good of AA? Next week, February 5th, the club is going to have the Super Bowl fundraiser, and our meeting is going to be canceled. So we won't have a meeting next week because of the club function. Any other announcements? Literature table, I have some pamphlets and some pictures for free. And I have some books at cost if you're interested. Are there any anniversaries of 1 year or more? Are there any out-of-town guests? Please silence your cell phones. We'll be passing the basket at this time. Court papers will be signed before the meeting starts. If you have to leave early, please feel free to do so. And there's the court papers. They've all been signed. Is there anyone sick or in the hospital that we can keep in our prayers? Let's take a moment of silence for those named. Amen. Oh, this is a home group. If you would like to join Beginner's Big Book, see one of our home group members. With the home group members, please raise your hand. Thank you. Alcoholics Anonymous Preamble. Alcoholics Anonymous is a fellowship of men and women who share their experience, strength, and hope with each other that they may solve their common problem and help others to recover from alcoholism. The only requirement for membership is the desire to stop drinking. There are no dues or fees for AA membership. We are self-supporting through our own contributions. AA is not allied with any sect, denomination, politics, organization, or institution, does not wish to engage in any controversy, neither endorses nor opposes any causes. Our primary purpose is to stay sober and help other alcoholics to achieve sobriety. Okay, tonight we're actually going to have a different format since it's the fifth Sunday of the month. Normally, on the first Sunday of the month, we take steps 1, 2, and 3. Second Sunday, we take 4, 5, 6, and 7. The third Sunday, we take 8, 9, and 10. And then the fourth Sunday, we take 11 and 12. Well, this month, we have 5 Sundays, so tonight we're going to change the format so we could stay on schedule for next week, or the following week, actually. And that way everybody knows on the first Sunday of the month, we always take the steps 1, 2, and 3 on the first Sunday of the month, and we never deviate from that. So tonight we're going to cover, we're going to have a meeting called Ask a Basket, where we actually have you write your questions down, and then we'll try to answer them the best of our ability, and then we'll throw them out to the floor. And so you can write your questions down anonymously. Nobody needs to know who wrote it. Everybody benefits from this, and you'll be surprised and interesting questions that come up. It's always a fun format, just kind of like a question and answer thing. Okay, here's a quote from our AA co-founder Bill Wilson, written in the 1958 AA Grapevine: "Sobriety, freedom from alcohol through the teaching and practice of the 12 steps, is the sole purpose of an AA group." End quote. Okay, let's see. All this doesn't apply. Okay, that pretty much covers the chairman part. Tonight, we're going to do an Ask a Basket where everybody's got a sheet of paper. Feel free to write a question, and we'll throw it in the basket. We'll take a shot at it, the best of our ability. Hopefully, it's out of the book of our experience, not opinions or theory. That way, we we can kind of stay on the straight and narrow, stay sober the best of our ability, experience strength and hope. So Harvey's got the basket. For those who want some time to write a question, please, you know, go ahead and write a question. And again, we'll try to answer them. If we have enough time, we might have a 5-minute quiet time for those who are interested. You know, we might be able to squeeze that in. That's always been good. Actually, that's my favorite. That's in the fourth session, the 11th step, the quiet time. That's always been one of my favorite sections to cover, where you actually take 5 minutes to be quiet with God of your understanding, and you write down your guidance and you share it with everybody. And then sometimes the guidance might be for somebody else in the room. And we use the four absolutes as a way of discerning if it's coming from God or if it's coming from you. And basically, if it passes all four absolutes, we believe it's God-directed guidance. If it fails one of the four absolutes, it's basically coming from self. And so, again, if we have enough time, maybe we can vote on that, and maybe we could squeeze that in. It depends on how many questions we get. Feel free to write any kind of question you want. No, there is no marijuana maintenance program in AA. So I've heard that. You'd be really surprised some of the questions sometimes. It's amazing. So if we're ready, we'll go around and collect questions, and we'll do round one. Okay. Carl, did you write a question?
I'm thinking.
You're thinking. Okay, got some questions. Good deal. I'm gonna shake them up.
Shake them up.
You want to go ahead?
You start.
Go ahead.
No, I want you to start.
All right, Mike Alcoholic.
Hey, Mike.
Oh, that's not good. Okay, first question. How do I deal with people who doubt my drive to stay sober? Do I
distance
myself from them? Well, we know that came from Casey. Okay, Mike Alcoholic.
Hey, Mike.
How do I deal with people who doubt my drive to stay sober? Well, basically, you have to stay sober for yourself. You know, you don't people please. You have to be true to yourself. That's one of my favorite quotes, to thine own self be true. You know, family members, I know all my uncles, my dad, my brother drank, and everybody was in the drinking world. And when I got sober back in 84, I was the only one. And so I broke the chain of alcoholism. I believe there's a lot of alcoholism in my family. They can doubt all they want. You can be a living example by your actions. You can't really convince them with your mind or, you know, talk or anything. It's by your actions. And when they see that you're getting better in AA and you're happy, joyous, and free, I mean, that's pretty much living proof that, you know, that this thing works. You know, just say, hey, I'm doing the best I can. I don't need to prove myself to you. All I have to do is, you know I have this and I have to deal with it. And then it says, how do I distance myself from them? Well, you just simply say, excuse me, I got to go. You know, it's like I got to go. You know, it's like I have to leave. If it's toxic, if it's, you know, they really are discouraging you versus encouraging, I want to be around people that are encouraging me and versus discouraging me. And that's one of the beauties of AA. You come into the meetings and we're all here for one purpose. You know, stay sober, work the steps, help each other, and that's the thing, you know. So that's the thing, one of the beauties of the meetings is when you come to a meeting and say, hey, I'm really out of gas, I'm really in bad shape. You could talk to a few people and you'd be amazed. It's happened to me where I've went to a meeting where I was totally fit to be tied. And when I left the meeting, it was like I was a different man. And it was amazing. And I've always, 99% of the time, I've always felt better after a meeting. And it's amazing. And it's a form of encouragement, and it's basically God's strength, our experience, and then the hope comes from the promises. So it's an experience from us. Our past is our most prized possession. And then the strength is God of your understanding, and the hope is the promises. So it's experience, strength, and hope. And so it's like there is such a thing as an alcoholic. He's physically different from others, and he's mentally thinking differently from others. And chapter 3 talks about how we don't like the idea of being different from our fellows, and we have the obsession to drink like normal people. And that's, again, the quote, "To thine own self be true." And I have to own this and concede to my innermost self that I truly am an alcoholic, and I understand the definition of an alcoholic.
I understand. I just want to say one thing. Part of that question is just the negative judgment, where I'm thinking, okay, no matter what I do, they have this judgment, they have this perception of me, and I don't want one day to say, screw it, that's what they think of me, then I might as well be what they,
When they start paying your rent, you might want to pay attention to them, okay? When they start paying your rent and say, okay, I'll consider that.
Right.
But they're not. So don't let them live in your head for free, You follow the best, do the best you can, keep your nose in the book, get through the steps, you'll be okay. I'll give it to Lisa.
Hi, Lisa, alcoholic.
Hi, Lisa.
This disease is a family disease, family and friends. So everybody in your life is ill who is close to you. They were affected by this. And it talks a lot about that in the family afterwards and to the wives, that you should expect that they're going to behave that way. When it was family members, what I did is I would set only a certain amount of time that I would spend. And, on holidays, I'll be there at 4, and I had already arranged to leave at 5, and I made sure that people knew in the program when I was going to be walking into around my relatives. I was dating somebody at the time that wasn't in the program, and I chose sobriety above that relationship. So, it's a tough, I think it's a tough thing, but it's normal. I think what Mike said is the key, and that is you have what you're to focus on right now, and it's not on people. Your disease will attempt to distract you from anything that will help you recover. And worrying about what other people are thinking, saying, doing, when you have no control over it, is nothing but a tool your disease is using to pull you back. So the steps don't include talking about the impact on other people until steps 8 and 9. And so I would say, at that point, just pray for them the way it says in the big book, because they're sick, they were affected by it, and focus on your own recovery and ask God for his help to help them as well as you, if that makes any sense.
Okay, we're going to throw this out on the floor for anybody that wants to take a shot at it. The question again is, how do I deal with people who doubt my drive to stay sober? Do I distance myself from them? So that's the question. Anybody want to answer or get a shot at that? What's your name again?
Ralph.
Ralph? Hey, Ralph.
Hi, Ralph.
Hi, Mike.
You only need your own approval. Another way of looking at it is what other people think about you is none of your business, really, even if they tell you.
Yeah, really.
That's
thanks.
Who cares? I mean, who are you living for, like you said, I think you've answered it very well. You got to do this for yourself. Whatever you do in life, you got to do it for yourself. If you're not, then thine own self be true.
Thank you. For those who are, we do an ask a basket. If you want to write a question down, throw it in the basket, please feel free.
Yeah, here's paper and pens.
Yeah.
Sure.
You can be totally anonymous, but we know you wrote it, though.
question, huh?
Yeah.
Maybe you don't put in there, Mike.
Uh-oh. That's the ringer. It's your turn.
Okay.
Shake it up.
Hey, the longer you're in here, the more questions
you have. Yeah, that's true. Is it necessary to go to breakfasts, anniversaries, dances, conferences, et cetera, et cetera? It's an interesting. The program of recovery is outlined in the first, 164 pages, and it's the 12 steps. And the 12 steps do not talk about going to breakfasts, anniversaries, dances, conferences, et cetera, as the way to get sober. However, each step of the 12 steps starts with the word we. And one of the things our disease will attempt to do is isolate us, because if it can get us alone, it can kill us. So the we is an important thing. How you work the we is entirely up to you. There's no requirement to go to breakfasts, anniversaries, dances, or anything else. So that's, you know, kind of my view in a nutshell. With that, I'll turn it over to Mike. All
right. Mike, alcoholic.
Hey, Mike.
Is it necessary to go to breakfast, anniversaries, dances, conferences, and
et cetera?
No, it's not necessary. I'll pass. It's just a fellowship thing. It's great. I've done it. It's wonderful. I love it. There's a swing in the spring in April up at Erie, PA. The whole weekend, you park, you go in there, get in the hotel Friday, you leave Sunday, it's like one giant meeting. You talk about charging your AA batteries. You never leave the hotel. You basically have everything. You have your room, you got your food, you go to your meetings, you take a nap, go to your meeting, to eat some food, take a nap, go to a meeting, you do the whole weekend. And they're on fire with AA. They love it up there. I love going to that conference. There's a conference in Marietta in July, where they actually have a riverboat, where they have a lead on a riverboat on Saturday, and I go to that. I enjoy that. That's an awesome, peaceful serenity thing. I love doing that. I've been to Founders Day in Akron many times. It's a wonderful thing, but again, it's a human power thing. And Lisa's point about the 12 steps, that's a higher power thing. So you got, you know, Joe and Charlie in the Big Book, they talk about two powers in AA. There's the power of the 12 steps to change you, and there's the power of the fellowship to support you. So they work hand in hand. It's a wonderful thing. I love dances. I love conferences, anniversaries. Anniversaries is like a celebration. It's a celebration. It's a wonderful thing. With that, I'll pass. Anybody else want to comment on that, or? What does emotional sobriety mean? Are you next?
No, you are.
Okay. What does emotional sobriety mean? Okay. Emotional sobriety for me is, Bill Wilson talks about it as the final frontier. Emotionally, they say one day at a time. Okay, what's that mean emotionally? Well, emotionally, if I think about the past, I can get emotional. You know, get angry, sad, glad, whatever. If I think about the future, I get anxious, fearful. I get emotional. I get emotions in the past and in the future. And emotional sobriety is basically being here right now emotionally. I'm all here. I'm not, you know, I'm physically here, but mentally I'm somewhere else. I'm physically here, I'm mentally here. So I'm in the here and now, and that's where God lives. That's where my higher power lives. That's where the power is. He doesn't live in the past. He doesn't live in the future. Our minds are so powerful that we can literally live in the past. I've come across people where you talk to them, and you swear they're in the 1980s. That's all they're talking about. You know, it's like they never got past the 1980s. You know, they're not here. And for me, the acceptance of reality is to stay in the here and now, and to accept what's happening right now, and to do the best you can. And for me, that's emotional sobriety. You know, stay calm, serene, peaceful, emotions, you know, can be very powerful. Well, that'll pass. There you go.
Hi, Lisa, alcoholic. To me, emotional sobriety is what step 10 is all about, where we watch for anything that causes us to be agitated or upset or fearful, and we take action on it rather than allow it to affect our emotions. Step 10 says sanity, we will have ceased fighting anything and everyone, even alcohol, for sanity will have returned. When my emotions are going up and down, it's pretty darn hard to stay sober. And the program gives a step that's aimed at working on that. For me, it's probably the hardest step to do. And with that, I'll pass. I'll open it up to the floor.
Mike.
Hi, Mike. Right.
There's a tape and also a handout on emotional sobriety. The handout is an article that Bill Wilson wrote for the, what's that magazine? The
Grapevine.
Grapevine. But that's all about emotional sobriety. And in there he talks about when we're like teenagers, we want ideal romance and the best job, and we want to be top dog, and we want the best of everything. Like, it's got to be ideal, perfect. That's okay when you're 17 or 18, but not when you're 55. He says in there, you know, it's like you got to get real. And I expect unrealistic things to happen to you. Absolute perfection and ideal situations. For me, emotional sobriety too is I used to have that bipolar thing going on where I was up but down, and, you know, manic one day, depressed as hell the next. That's kind of left me over the years, and depression has left me too. That's another thing. You know, I was chronically depressed a lot with the mania every once in a while. Paranoia has left me. Obsessive compulsive thinking and behavior is gone. Eventually all that leaves. I mean, I believe it. I mean, it's happened to me. And I ended up in mental hospitals over all that stuff. That's part of my emotional sobriety. A lot of people come in here very, very angry, like Lisa was talking about, very, very angry and resentful. You know, the steps, especially step 10, like you're talking about, you can get rid of that kind of stuff too. So you can mellow out, you know. Yeah. I'll pass.
Thanks, Mike.
Thanks, Mike.
Okay, it's your turn.
No, I just didn't. Is it my turn?
Yeah.
I consider smoking marijuana to be outside help. What do you think?
Read that again. What's that say again?
I consider smoking marijuana to be outside help. What do you think? If you are medically prescribed something by a doctor, that is considered, I think, outside help. But if you are medicating yourself, and you're helping yourself outside of the rooms, that does not fall under seek outside help. Bottom line, you know, anything that is mood or mind altering is a block between you and your higher power. You know, it's the program, how it works, says the core of the entire program is rigorous honesty. Those who cannot succeed or those who cannot or will not become completely honest with themselves. So I'm going to turn this back on whoever wrote it and say, in all honesty with yourself, what do you think? With that, I'll pass.
All right. Mike, alcoholic. I consider smoking marijuana to be outside help. What do you think? No, it's not. to Lisa's point about prescription, nowadays, the last year or two in California, they're prescribing marijuana, and technically it's legal that way, but a few years ago it was illegal, and it's considered something that would change your mood or alter your consciousness. So again, if you're truly an alcoholic, and I was kidding earlier at the beginning about the marijuana maintenance program, but that's truly been a question that somebody asked. I don't care if it's marijuana or cornflakes. If it gets you off or changes your mood or changes something, you know, something outside of you that changes you, this is an inside job. You know, God's going to change you. This is the spiritual awakening, the spiritual experience, the psychic change. You know, that's where it's got to come from, inside out, not outside in. I don't think consider it, well, you know, I smoked a lot of pot in the 70s, so I can't speak on this. I was never powerless over it. I would smoke a couple joints, and I just, you know, it was like I enjoyed it, but I was never powerless over it. I could drop it like a hot potato. I consider it as clouding your mind, and you're not thinking straight. Again, anything outside of you, you need to get something outside of you to make you feel all right, to be okay, to be whole. I think there's question. That's questionable. With that, I'll pass.
Thanks, Eric.
Anybody else? Okay, my turn. Okay, we're gonna shake it up. It's this one right here. Okay, which one of the 12 steps that you have to do 100% at all times? Well, they say step one, you have to do 100% at all times. Basically, step one says, I'm powerless over alcohol. So once you establish the definition of an alcoholic and you understand that the definition of an alcoholic is, when he drinks alcohol in his body, he physically craves it. And if he's not drinking it, he's thinking about it all the time, and that's called the mental obsession. So when you say, I concede to my innermost self that I'm an alcoholic, you're saying that I have a body that cannot tolerate alcohol physically, and I have a mind that thinks differently. I have a perception problem where I think it's okay to drink, even after you've recognized that you are an alcoholic. And that's what they call insanity in the big book. And that's in step two, could restore us to sanity. So step one, 100%, is to say, yeah, I'm an alcoholic. Yes, that's 100%, absolutely. I'm 100% alcoholic. I'll be 100% alcoholic after I'm dead for 3 days. I'm still alcoholic. I've got a body and a mind that is an alcoholic. And I own that. That's true. I am an alcoholic. So knowing that, you know, that's 100%, yeah. And then the rest, they talk about spiritual progress versus spiritual perfection. We try to live along spiritual principles the best of our abilities. So again, two steps forward, one step back. We do the best we can. We make mistakes. That's what step 10 says. We try to set right the new mistakes as we go along. So I would say step one is 100%. Step two, you believe or you don't believe. Is God everything or is he nothing? Is it 100% or is he nothing? You know, that's a step two question. God is either everything or he's nothing. What's your answer? Is he everything or is he nothing? That's pretty 100% to me. And I'll pass with that. Yeah.
Which of the 12 steps do you have to work 100% at all times? Well, you know, I would agree with what Mike has said, and it's what I've heard a lot, and that is it's step one. I've known a lot of people, though, who I don't know if everybody could say that they, you know, when I see absolute words like 100% and all time, if I'm not capable of doing anything 100% at all times, except maybe breathe, which is something I'm not doing, something that I'm given. So I think, you know, in the in the sense of how it's meant, it's step one. With that, I pass and open it for comments.
Thanks.
Hey, Harvey.
I put that question in there, and the reason I put it in there, I was to see if anybody was on the same program as I'm on. The data reflection tell you, December the 26th, that step one is the only step that you have to do 100% at all times. It's in the data reflection, December the 26th. At all times. Now, whether I do it at all times, I can't say that, because I'm not perfect. I'm not perfect. If I was perfect, maybe I could. But I'm not perfect. With that, I pass.
Thanks, Harvey.
Thanks, sir.
Well, Mike, I'm
Hey, Mike.
I just like to mention that the big book says none of us has maintained anything like perfect adherence to these principles. So, I don't know. As far as the first step is concerned, I spent a long time in AA denying I was an alcoholic. I just didn't want to drink anymore, and they told me, well, the only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. So I said, okay, on that basis, I'll be a member. But I stopped. That's what I wanted to do when I came in. I want to stop drinking. I didn't think I was an alcoholic. I really didn't. And I stayed here long enough to find out that I am an alcoholic. And when I did that, then I was able to honestly take the first step. I discovered that I was powerless over alcohol, except for this program. Except for the fellowship. The fellowship is very powerful. You can stay sober or at least dry on the fellowship for a long time. Eventually you may drink, or you may stay dry. And you'll have a lot of dry drunks. It might be have a white knuckle sobriety, just fellowship, but fellowship is very powerful. I stayed sober on the fellowship for just 3-6 months, I don't know what it was, before I really got into the steps. But as far as 100% all of the time, I think it's desire. I think it's that sometimes I think the first step is really having that desire to stop drinking. Without that, it doesn't matter. So none of us has maintained anything like perfect adherence to these principles. Well, that I pass.
Thanks, Mike.
It's a lot of responsibility. Is a lot of responsibility bad for sobriety? Work, school, meetings, grandpa or family, friends, probation? Ooh, that's a good one. Good question for me. I'm going to use a different word than responsibility. I'm going to keep it simple. Sobriety has to be your number one in your life. And when you start allowing work, school, meetings, grandpa, family, friends, probation to take priority over your program, your sobriety. And I don't mean just going to meetings. I mean your relationship with your higher power, working the steps on a daily basis. You will very quickly not have to worry about work, school, meetings, grandpa, family, or anything else. So, you know, the whole issue, I hear people talk about how do I balance this, how do I balance that. I think the simple answer is keep it simple, make your sobriety your number one responsibility every day, and let the rest fall into place. With that, I pass.
Thanks, Lisa. Mike, alcoholic. Is a lot of responsibility bad for sobriety? Work, I can't read that. Grandpa, family, etc. I think the word responsibility is definitions is to able to respond. Responsibility, able to respond. And to Lisa's point about balance. At some point, and I tell the guys, I say, you know, if you're not sober, you're not going to have a job. You're not going to have a wife. You're not going to have blah, blah, blah. You're not going to have any of that. So sobriety, you have to establish your sobriety and relationship with a higher power and, you know, trust God, clean house, and help others as a way of life. They say that. It's the design for living. It's a way of life. And all that will come in time. You know, the balance will come back where you're able to respond and be with family. But until you can establish a sobriety, you're going to be at another detox. You're going to be at Skid Row. You know, the alcoholism is going to take you out. So you're not, like Lisa said, you're not going to have all that stuff anyway. So that should be on, like, top of the list. That's where it starts. I heard a lead once, Adam T. talks about if you don't do the steps, the work in 4 through 9, you know, he went to 28 rehabs, and his sponsor said he spent $500,000 on a big book. But basically, his point was this: I can lease all that stuff for 90 days. I can lease the girlfriend, the job, the car, all that for 90 days, and I'm back in pajamas. I'm back with a bracelet in 90 days. I can lease it all for 90 days. And so the work is in 4 through 9. Do the work, clean up the wreckage of the past, and then help others pass this on. And all that will come back naturally. I think that balance will come back naturally. I knew a guy that came out of prison. He went to meeting for 6 years straight. For him, you know, some say it's hiding in AA. I don't know. They say get a solid foundation. You know, Newberg says, watch well your beginnings. The results will take care of themselves. So, you know, 1 year commitment at a home group, perhaps two. Make a commitment, you know, land. Be responsible, able to respond. Well, that'll pass. Anybody else?
Yeah, Mike, come on. Mike. I think this may or may not be related to kind of traditional thing they say in AA, which is no major decisions for a year, they say. And I think that's reason for that is because you make a major decision like job change or accepting a high level job or getting married, whatever you want to do, you know, it can cause a lot of stress and pressure, put a lot of pressure and stress on you. And you don't want to do that when you're kind of new in sobriety. You want to kind of take it easy. That's why they say easy does it. Go slow, easy does it. And responsibility, if you take on a lot of responsibilities that you really don't have to take on, you may come in with responsibilities, or think you have them. But I would say don't put anything on yourself that you can't really deal with, or may make you drink. I like that, hiding out in AA. I think there was a longtime member of AA named Dick Poutney. And he was a big time at drug, and I mean really the worst I ever heard. And they were kind of riding him. His buddies were, you know, I don't know who was riding them. They were saying, "You're hiding out in AA. You're hiding out in AA." He says, "You're damn right, I'm hiding out." That bottle beat my brains in. I'm hiding out, man. You bet I'm hiding out. So, it's a lot easier to stay sober without a lot of pressure and stress on yourself. Putting a lot of pressure and stress on yourself. So I'll pass with that.
Thanks, Mike. Is it your turn? My turn. It's your turn. Go ahead.
I consider caffeine, nicotine, and sugar to be mind and mood altering substances. Why are they so accepted and even in a way promoted in AA? Well, I will address the fact I don't believe they're promoted. Sugar is used during detox. So the only time I've heard it promoted in AA to use sugar is when somebody is brand new in the program. And that's because in the early days, you know, that's what they used, KO syrup, and because alcoholism is related to, in a sense, to diabetes and a sugar metabolism issue. So the only thing I've heard promoted in AA is sugar. They offer coffee at meetings, but a lot of times they offer both decaf and regular. So I can't say they're offering caffeine. You know, if they were promoting or selling caffeine pills, then I would agree that AA is promoting that people take caffeine. But I understand the question. I guess I don't have a good answer to it. You could say a lot of things are mood and mind altering. Sex is mood and mind altering. Sleeping is mood and mind altering. Not sleeping is mood and mind altering. I think the issue is working our program and staying away from things that we use to intentionally numb how we feel. And I think AA promotes only and mainly just a program of recovery based on finding a power greater than yourself. And they don't name that power caffeine, nicotine, sugar, or anything else. So with that, I'll give it to Mike.
Okay. I consider caffeine, nicotine, and sugar to be mind and mood altering substances. Why are they so accepted and even promoted in AA? Caffeine, nicotine, and sugar is mind and mood altering. I agree. That's true. And they're accepted in AA. Lisa's point, there's a quote in the book about candy, giving somebody candy if they're newly sober, KR syrup and orange juice, as a way of metabolizing their body, stabilizing their body. So they do promote that a little bit, but that's only when you're new. You got to realize when they did this, they actually detoxed in the homes. And so people were dying from alcohol. You stop on a dime in alcoholism, you can die. So it's very dangerous. I don't think coffee is promoted. It's their take it or leave it. Lisa's point, caffeine, non-caffeine, the sugar, the nicotine. Both our founders died of cancer. Bill Wilson died of emphysema. Dr. Bob died of cancer. I don't know if it was lung cancer. He died of cancer. I came in at meetings in the 80s. It was all smoking meetings, and I'd come in, and it would be a blue haze. It was just a blue haze. It was just all of them were smoking meetings. That's gone away in the last few years. The Oxford group, where AA got its beginnings, you know, they would consider caffeine, nicotine, and sugar as something questionable that you need to eliminate out of your life. Bill Wilson didn't feel so. He was just worried about his alcoholism because that was what's going to kill you. It was going to kill you. You know, caffeine, the nicotine would probably get you in about 30 or 40 years. I eat donuts. I used to smoke. I stopped in 93, and I drink coffee at regular. I used to drink 10 cups a day, and I would get on a pretty good jag. I only drink 2 or 3 cups. Sure, it gives me a lift. I enjoy coffee. Again, it's take it or leave it. I don't think coffee's promoted. The smoking, it's on you if you want to smoke or not. So basically, in the Oxford group, they would say, get rid of the caffeine, get rid of the nicotine, get rid of the sugar. And they even have a story in the book where the wife was harping on the husband about that stuff. And he got mad. You know, he's trying to get sober, newly sobered, and the wife was saying, get rid of this, get rid of that. And it says, well, let's address the alcoholism because that's going to kill you. But the Oxford group would say, all of it's got to go. And Bill Wilson say, no, I just want to, that's when he broke from the Oxford group. And he said, I'm going to address the alcoholism. And he smoked himself to death at 71. There was an old-timer from the Oxford group. He said that the Oxford group wanted to fix all the dents in the car. And Bill Wilson, he just wanted to get the oil changed. I'll put it out to the floor.
Hi, Harvey.
Hi, Harvey.
But you didn't finish the story about the wife nagging the husband for smoking so much. She nagged him so much about stop smoking that he went out and picked up that drink again. She found out that she was the cause of him going back out and getting that drink. She apologized to him and said, smoke all you want. Just don't pick up the alcohol. And that's what he did, you know. You can to me, I smoke, but I don't concentrate on smoking. I concentrate on the worst enemy, and that was that alcohol. If I don't pick it up today, I got another day. What did I find?
Thanks, sir.
Thanks, Harvey.
Mike. Hey, Mike.
I just throw this out there. Doing the 12 steps is a mind and move all in. So, and that's really promoted.
Okay, next question. Okay. What other books besides the big book are necessary to read? I don't think any other book is necessary. The big book, again, has been proven to work. There's living examples of the big book working. They applied the information in the book. It's a textbook. There's other books you can read, sure, but the actual steps are in the big book. They're not in the 12 and 12. The 12 and 12 is essays put together by one man and a ghostwriter. The big book was put together with over 40 alcoholics, and they covered every angle. No alcoholic has beat it. So I would say the only book that's necessary for an alcoholic to get sober is the big book. The rest of it is optional. They did promote in the early days the Sermon on the Mount by Emmett Fox in the detox down at St. Thomas. As soon as your eyes could focus, they gave you a book of that, and they said, read this. And they had the Bible. You know, these are the early roots, you know. But the big book was put together for you to get sober. It's called a textbook. You know, follow the directions and get the results. So I would consider that the only one necessary. In this meeting, that's the only thing we use is the book, the big book. There's other stuff out there. People get it hooked into that 12 and 12, and it's like it's their essays. It's, you know, he's talking about stuff. You know, he's not telling you this is what we did based on 40 people who were low bottom drunks who were going to die. Their experiences were written down. So it's important to understand that. I consider the big book necessary. I'll pass.
I completely agree. At one point I had like 8 meditation books, you know, and I'm trying to read each of these books every day. I agree completely with Mike. The only book that's the critical and necessary one to read is the first 164 pages of the big book. I open it to the floor. I feel burned out with AA. I am a long-term member. What should I do? My question always when I hear this is, what are you calling AA? To me, the AA program is very simple and working the steps and focusing on that. If you're burned out from, is it meetings? Is it, you know, what is it? And the bottom line of whenever there's a problem like this, are you asking God for direction on it? You know, it says when we're feeling, you know, angry or tired or fearful or any of these, you know, we ask God for inspiration, an intuitive thought. So that to me is what you should do. First, ask yourself what you're calling AA, and then take the problem to your higher power. With that, I turn it to Mike.
Mike, alcoholic. I feel burned out with AA. I'm a longtime member. What should I do? Work with others. We use the set-aside prayer. The set-aside prayer is to set, you know, you have all this information and experience over the decades or how long you've been in the program. You've seen it all, been around the block, blah, blah, blah. Set that all aside, put it off to the side, and approach this with an open mind, a clean slate, have a new experience, experience some truth. And so being burnt out, what comes to mind is like if you're at work and you keep doing the same thing over and over and over and you're doing 60 hours a week for a year, you get burnt out. You just get in a rut. You get burned out. You're doing the same thing over and over again. You get burned out. You do something different. Working with others, you'll be surprised what comes out of your mouth when you ask God to help you. It's like, did I say that? You know, it's like, it's amazing. It's just living in the moment, working with others, and this thing comes alive. And, you know, you heard people say quality, sobriety versus quantity. What's quality? I mean, you got that sparkle in your eye? Is the spirit there? Is it at home? You feeding your spirit? You know, are you helping others? Are you got the power, with the power to change lives? Are you using that power? Because we're one alcoholic talking to another alcoholic, we can gain their confidence in a few hours. Everybody else, it's just a lecture. And so I think, you know, when I lived down in Akron, I went with Jim Crawford, an old-timer. We used to go down to the jailhouse on Friday. And, you know, I would help him out. You know, he would go down there every Friday. And basically, I remember one time driving down to his house, and I had this amazing weight lifted off of me, and I felt it was self-pity. I was feeling sorry for myself, and I was getting out of myself to go to the jail meeting to help others the best I can, and it's a wonderful feeling. And your ego, you know, can't do that. I think the spirit, the power, greater than yourself, you know, the ninth step promises, says, we'll intuitively know how to handle situations that used to baffle us. God's doing for us what we couldn't do for ourselves. And to Lisa's point, take it in meditation. That's one of my favorite quotes in the book, The Sex Inventory. It says, if sex is very troublesome, like any other problem, ask God in meditation for the correct answer. So like any other problem, well, I'm burned out in AA, that's a problem. Ask God in meditation and get quiet and then see what kind of guidance you get. And then if you get directions or guidance, act on it. The power will be there. The power will be there. Act on it in the moment. I think if you say, well, I'll wait till next week, again, I think that's just kind of like, you know, for me, that's not how I approach it. And I'll pass with that.
Thanks, Mike.
Anybody else? I feel burned out in AA. I'm a long-time member. What should I do? All right. Isn't AA a crutch? No. If you break your leg, you got a crutch. And as soon as your leg heals, you get rid of the crutch. Does that make sense? Okay, so if you're an AA and you get away from the AA principles and working with others, you're going to go back to drinking. I believe that with all my heart. So I don't know if AA is a crutch. I think in the beginning, you need all the help you can get and get the right kind of help. To answer your question, I don't think AA is a crutch. It's a way of living. It's a fellowship. It's a design for living. You're going to experience a new happiness. So it's a way of living. It's not a crutch. It's not a temporary thing. Where if you break your leg, it's a crutch. It's temporary. You throw it away after you heal. I think human nature is such that if you don't keep your nose in the principles and help others, you're going to go back to drinking. That's just my experience. Well, that'll pass.
Thank you, Mike.
From a simple standpoint, would you say that insulin is a crutch to a diabetic? Well, alcoholism is considered a true medical disease, so this is our medicine. Just like diabetes, you're never cured of, we're never cured of alcoholism. So I don't think it's a crutch from that standpoint. I think it's necessary medicine. So with that, I'll open it for other people's input.
My alcoholism
Hey, Mike.
Let's say AA is a crutch. Would you rather have the positive, uplifting crutch of AA or the negative, debilitating crutch of alcohol? My pass.
Was that too far a question, Lisa?
No.
I thought you was on diabetic.
No.
What was your own this?
No, I was answering the, is AA a crutch?
No, what did you say about diabetic?
Oh, I said that just like, would you ask a diabetic whether insulin is a crutch?
Oh, okay, I'm sorry, I got you.
You know, diabetes is a medical disease, so is alcoholism.
Sure.
This is our medicine.
Sure.
Neither's curable.
Sure.
You have to take medicine for life.
Yeah. Harvey Alcoholics.
Hey, Harvey.
Yeah, AA is my medicine, and insulin is my medicine. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I got two of them I work on a daily basis. If I don't work on them, then something's going to happen bad. Not good, it's going to happen bad. I need the insulin every day, so I take it every day. I need to come to these meetings, pray and meditate, not to pick up that drink today. So I do that too. So I got two things working positive for me. If I do it, I'll continue today. But that I'm fast.
Thank you.
Say one other thing. I think the word crutch can be synonymous with the word help. Help. Yeah. I mean, it's a crutch, I guess, when people use the word crutch. And I this happened to me when I came in AA. I said, "Oh, you, yeah, AA's a crutch, man." So you, well, I think with males especially, it's in they don't need help. You know, I'll do it myself. Need no crutch. So, but you got to. If you're an alcoholic and you're powerless over alcohol, you're gonna need some kind of help to get over that. You know, some outside help, something outside of yourself, you know, a higher power in AA or. So, just think of it as help. I guess. I don't know if that helps.
Thanks, Mike.
Casey, alcoholic.
Hey, Casey.
You know, I mean, kind of saying what Mike said before, but every time I'm pretty much classified as a chronic relapser. Every time I've gone out, it's because I stopped going to meetings. And even if the perception of AA is a crutch, I don't care. I'm not ashamed to admit it. Like you said before, I'd rather live a positive, healthy lifestyle with a crutch, the AA, or live a miserable, depleting lifestyle as alcohol is my crutch. One or another, and in this whole experience with AA, I'm truly humbled. When I first went in these meetings back 3 years ago, I thought I was above everybody else. I thought, hey, I don't belong here. I'm above you. Yeah. No. So even if it is a crutch, I have no shame in admitting it. Fine. Helps me out. Thank you.
Thanks, Casey.
I am taking antipsychotic medication. Am I sober? I've been told I am not. I'm going to comment that nobody in AA should be telling anybody what medically they should take or not take. Unless the person in AA who is telling you what you should do with your medicine is your doctor, don't listen to that when it comes to your medical health, because I think that's the safest answer to give. You know, I am not qualified to make a statement on what somebody should take or not take for a medical condition. That said, I will share from my own experience that for myself, I asked myself a question, and that was, before my alcoholism, did I have a problem that required antidepressants, bipolar medicine, or the rest of this? Because alcoholism can trigger that kind of a chemical imbalance. Even if I answer, no, I did not, and this mental imbalance is due to my alcoholism, it's still not something you should just stop on your own without getting medical help. I've also met people in the program who truly are schizophrenic. They were schizophrenic before they ever drank. And if they don't take their medication, they will become very ill and drink again. So that's why I just don't think this is a question that people in AA are necessarily qualified to answer. So with that, I will give it to Mike.
I am taking antipsychotic medication. Am I sober? I've been told I'm not. And again, Lisa's point, I don't want to touch this with a 10-foot pole. I'm not a doctor, okay? So I'm not even going to go there. It's none of my business. What between you and your doctor, and I'm not qualified. You're taking opinions from addicts and drunks, okay? Think about it, really, okay? And they're playing with your life. And what other people think, it's like Mike said, it's none of their, you know, it's none of my business. They can think of anything they want. What's true for me and what's true with my doctor, period. I mean, that's where I draw the line. I knew a guy, manic depressive, quit taking his pills, you know, and he had an episode, blah, blah, blah. God bless him, you know, but for the grace of God, go I. I have an opinion on medication, but again, that's a personal opinion between me and somebody else one-on-one. If it's appropriate with the doctor, I mean, that's where it belongs. It doesn't belong. I'm not a doctor, and I can't say, oh, I'm prescribing for you. Don't take that script, you know. So with that, I'm going to stop there and just say, it's none of my business. It's between you and your doctor, and that's where it stays. That will pass.
I want to make just one quick comment on this. The question was very specific. Am I sober? I've been told I'm not. If you are under the care of a doctor who is treating you for medication and you're not drinking, then yes, you are sober, and whoever told you you're not is full of it. It's that simple.
Anybody else want to comment?
Mark, yeah. I agree with what you both said.
Yes, you do. I agree with you too, Mike.
To Lisa's point about drinking alcohol, you know, it says in chapter 5, we deal with alcohol. It says that. That's verbatim. We deal with alcohol, you know, and that's what we deal with. That's our primary purpose. We're after overtime, we're at 7:35. Do we have time for one more question, or are we going to wrap it up?
We have three more questions. Can we finish them up?
Or do you want to say the Lord's Prayer? We got a group conscience.
Finish the questions?
Okay. You're next. Okay, all right. I hear you can keep sober by just going to meetings. Why should I do the steps? Mike, alcoholic. Meetings have human beings, and that's a human power. There could be the presence of God in the meetings, but human beings have a human power. And it says in the ABCs on 60B, probably no human power can relieve our alcoholism. Probably, in my opinion, no human power can keep me sober. My dad can't keep me sober. I can't keep me sober. No human power can do it. And that's what meetings are. They're human beings. That's where the fellowship will encourage you and support you. But the steps will change you. You'll have a psychic change. Psychic means mind. You'll have a psychic change. Ideas, emotions, and attitudes will be cast to one side. You'll be a different person. You'll have that step 10 promise where you'll be in a state of neutrality, safe and protected. The drink problem has been removed. It does not exist. It's gone. That's the insanity of alcoholism. We go back to the insanity of alcoholism. We go back to drinking. It's gone. We're in a state of neutrality. That's our spiritual condition. So the steps give you that. The meetings are important because, to Lisa's point, isolation is one of the things that we have identified. I agree with that. Staying at home, watching TV, playing games on a computer, and you know, my best thinking got me drunk. When I come to meetings and I say, hey, you know, I think this and this and this and this, and your sponsor or somebody is co-sponsoring say, hey, you're full of it, you know, it clears it up really fast, and it's like you get out of that delusional thinking. Hopefully you'll have some good AA, some healthy AA. Everybody's working the steps to their best of their ability, and they're not going to co-sign your BS. You know, I can always get an A+ when I grade my own paper. So with that, I'll pass.
I think Mike said it already, and you know, if it were that simple, it would have said the book would be 2 pages long, and it would have been the title page, and then it would have said, find a group of other drunks that don't want to drink anymore and hang out with them. End of story. I can share from my own experience, as Mike has. I've heard from Mike's background. Yeah, you can stay dry for a period of time. You can feel like you're sober for a period of time, but when life happens, which it will happen, and you get something thrown at you, you will do one of two things. You will either drink, or you will, at that point, work those steps. Because no human power can replace what, let's be realistic, what did alcohol and drugs do for us? They anesthetized us. Things weren't so painful when we were under the influence, right? Well, take that away. Do you think just a bunch of people are going to prevent you from emotional pain the rest of your life? You know, they're here to support. But what's the solution? The solution is the 12 steps. And that's why there's a book dedicated to that. And I can honestly say that from my own experience, too. So I'll open it for any other comments. Step 1 has 2 parts. How many parts does step 12 have? 3 parts. Sounds like a Harvey question.
Harvey, alcohol. Let Mike go ahead and then I explain. Go ahead, Mike. You
done?
No, it has 3 parts. Step 12 has 3 parts.
Okay.
For me, it does. Having had a spiritual awakening, we try to carry the message to others, and we try to practice these principles in all of our affairs. So, with that,
I agree with Lisa, Mike Alcoholic. Step 1 has 2 parts. How many parts are in step 12? And again, what Lisa said, we had a spiritual awakening. A power greater ourselves has gotten us sober. We practice the principles of the 4 absolutes, 12 steps, and there's a ton more in there. And we carry that message. We don't carry the mess. We carry that message to another alcoholic. So there's 3 parts there. I think, what is it, chapter 7? The whole book, the whole chapter 7 is on step 12. It tells you how to approach another alcoholic, what to say, when to say it, how to say it, when to do it, blah, blah, blah. So I think it's chapter 7, into action, helping others, and how to do a 12-step call. So the actual carrying the message has a lot of details and a lot of instructions. So yes, to answer the question, there are 3 parts to step 12. We'll pass that.
Harvey.
Hi, Harvey.
All right.
Now, I found it in the big book, but I couldn't find out how many parts was to step 12. So I went for the day, and I asked the guy, I had 20 years, and how many parts to step 12 have? He said 2. Then I went to 280th Street, and I asked the guy that had 15 years, and he said 2. So I didn't know. I couldn't find it in the book. And that's what I was going to ask you last week. And I said, no, I'll wait till I come to the Ask It basket and see what his answer would be, Lisa's answer would be. And it's 3 parts. I went 1, 2, and then I couldn't get the other 3rd to come in, you know. So I said 2 myself, but now I know it's 3. Okay. Okay.
Thanks, Harvey.
Well,
if you consider the first part of the 12th step, it says, having had a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps, which would be the previous 11.
Yeah, I know. I thought the same thing.
Then you've only got 2 parts left.
Yeah.
We try to carry
it's a trick muscle. Question, in other words.
Mike Alcoholic, I don't want to crosstalk and comment twice on the same question, but basically, you know, just to keep it simple, I think there's 3 steps. You know, everybody can have their own opinion, but I think there's 3 different parts to that step. Spiritual awakening, carry the message, practice the principles. Does that make sense?
Sure.
Yeah? Okay, what happens when you are called to be a vessel so others, such as helping someone AA in a situation or circumstance, can witness the power of change in sobriety through you? What happens when you are called to be a vessel so others, such as helping someone a situation or circumstance, can witness the power of change and sobriety through you? What happens is that you basically perform a miracle. Somebody who thinks he's going to die of alcoholism, you do a 12-step call and say, hey, you don't have to live like this. You know, I'm living proof this thing works. I give all the credit to my higher power in AA. I didn't do it. I followed directions and I got results. And so, you know, again, a vessel or a channel. They talk about a channel, you know, a channel of, you know, in I think it's on the fear, how to remove fear. Ask God to be a channel. You know, and they talk about for the grace of God. So grace is going to go through me. I have to be spiritually fit. So grace goes through me. So I have the power to help others change lives. And it changes my life. So, you know, I think it's important to, you know, be a living example. A walking big book, they say. You might be the only big book somebody sees. Hopefully, I don't want to be president of AA in this meeting and then go home and kick the dog, you know. But practice these principles in all our affairs, you know, 24/7. So the power of change and sobriety through you. I think the results speak for themselves. Well, that'll pass.
All I can say is that when I have been used as a vessel, I am humbled. And I've sat back and thought, those were not my words. You know, it was as if I knew, as if I had been used as a vessel. I think there's a difference between that and what I would call these people who become like super sponsors, who they become like the power. So they aren't really a vessel anymore. You know, they're trying to preach about, you know, what should be done. And I think there's a big difference between my trying to tell you what to do versus my getting out of the way and allowing God to work a miracle through me. And there's a tremendous impact in the difference when those two things occur. So with that, I'll...
That's the last question. So that wraps up Ask a Basket. So I don't know when the next fifth Sunday is going to happen, but we'll probably do this again. So hopefully everybody enjoyed it.
I just want to say that I wrote that, so.
Okay.
That's the word. You guys answered that very well.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. I mean, that's what it, because before I came to AA, I was in study with the Word, with the Bible and stuff like that. So nowadays, now that I got off alcohol and drugs 2 years, 239 days ago, I'm really appreciating the sobriety and the sense of helping another person, putting myself last, and then putting somebody else's situation, big time situations here. Working with, you know, I'm a mental health advocate, you know, for the Adams Board, so I work all around the board. Academic researcher has bounced back from the system and things of that nature, and decided, now God decided for me, now I got a purpose for you. Now I got your calling here, Corey. Now I got your direction. Now I'm going to give you the appropriate identity and balance form that you've been praying to me about 15 years ago. I'm going to bring that all accountable for you. So now, you know, I help a lot of people in, you know, some really big ways. And I just wondered how you guys felt about that on the AA side, where she mentioned, you know, these individuals kind of cross over to preaching more so. You know, they do, you know, they cross over as a vessel to something else. And that gave me a little bit of understanding today that I didn't have yesterday and this last hour. So, you know, I look for people who can advise me once in a while. I do believe in leadership. You know, I have a strong leadership and influence on people. So I do consider myself to be distinguished from others, and that's what I want to be. I want to be able to help somebody's situation in a way that really impacts them and makes a difference on what they were doing 8 or 9 years ago. here I come into your life 3 months, and things have drastically changed for this situation that we were just working on. Because I called, and I called a few AA buddies and NA buddies, and got this moving in a direction that hasn't even been moved in a long time. Because, like you said, the power of grace comes through you. You really don't even realize you're even saying this off. You know, you're doing this. You're illustrating this. You're demonstrating this. Becoming a vessel for so others can see God through you. So, you know, a person was not a believer but had the potential to be a believer. Now she says, hey, can I pray with you, or want to go to church on New Year's Eve? Hey, come on, I'll show you how to do it. Now, you know, now she becomes a disciple also of the message of, you know, Narcotics Anonymous, AA, as well as this deep spirituality that flows through here too. So I appreciate you guys tonight.
All right, thank you. So that pretty much wrap it up? Okay, we're going to close with the Lord's Prayer.
We do in the legacy of our ball. Founders, we will close this meeting without holding hands with the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
It was a good meeting.
Yeah.
You want me to pass these out?